about you, some of the kids around here won't appreciate what I'm fixing to say, but I don't know what happened to this year. It was gone. I was thinking just last week, seems like something happened my senior year of high school. And somebody found a little clock somewhere, and they started speeding it up. And I got married, and it got faster, and I had one kid, and it got faster, and I had a second kid, and it got faster, and now four of them, and it's still faster. And I'll wake up in the morning, it'll be Christmas again. I'm just amazed at how quick time seems to travel. I know it's not going any faster than it was when I was a young one, like some of those sitting there toward the back and some of these up front. Seemed like forever from birthday to birthday. My goodness, I always wanted to be older. Now I just don't know what's happening to them all. But Genesis 35, we'll read through the first 15 verses of the chapter and just kind of spend some time maybe looking back and looking forward. Genesis 35, verse number 1, "And God had said unto Jacob, Arise, go up to Bethel, and dwell there, and make there an altar unto God that appeared unto thee when thou fleddest from the face of Esau thy brother. And then Jacob said unto his household and to all that were with him, Put away the strange gods that are among you, and be clean, and change your garments. And let us arise and go up to Bethel, and I will make there an altar unto God, who answered me in the day of my distress, and was with me in the way which I went. And they gave unto Jacob all the strange gods which were in their hand, and all their earrings which were in their ears. And Jacob hid them under the oak which was by Shechem. And they journeyed, and the terror of God was upon the cities that were round about them. And they did not pursue after the sons of Jacob. So Jacob came to Luz, which is in the land of Canaan, that is Bethel, he and all the people that were with him. And he built there an altar and called the place El Bethel, because of there God appeared unto him when he fled from the face of his brother. But Deborah, Rebekah's nurse, died, and she was buried beneath Bethel under an oak, and the name of it was Allen Bacuth. And God appeared unto Jacob again when he came out of Paddan Aram and blessed him. And God said unto him, Thy name is Jacob. Thy name shall not be called any more Jacob, but Israel shall be thy name. And he called him Israel. And God said unto him, I am God Almighty. Be fruitful and multiply. A nation and a company of nations shall be of thee, and kings shall come out of thy loins. And the land which I gave Abraham and Isaac to thee, I will give it, and to thy seed after thee will I give the land. And God went up from him in the place where he talked with him. And Jacob set up a pillar in the place where he talked with him, even a pillar of stone. And he poured a drink offering thereon, and he poured oil thereon. And Jacob called the name of the place where God spake with him, Bethel. The lives of Old Testament characters have always been very interesting to me. I think about how different the world was that they lived in compared to ours. I mean, Jacob never had a computer crash on him. He never had to worry about responding to an email. He never had to worry about changing a light bulb. There are a lot of these modern things that we call conveniences that I imagine would just boggle his mind if he could see it today. But I don't know that our life is much better because of many of the things we call progresses and many of the conveniences that we have. There are times I look back and think, well, I'd like to go back and live that way for a little while. And then I get to thinking about electricity, and I change my mind and think, no, I'm just happy where I am. But in spite of the differences in culture and the differences in technology between our day and the day that we read of here in Genesis chapter 35, I find when I read through these Old Testament events that these people have the same nature that I have, and they deal with the same problems that you and I deal with. None of that has changed over the years. It might come in a little different packaging, but for the most part, we face the same difficulties and the same troubles. Excuse me. And that's certainly the case in the life of this man that we'll consider for a few moments tonight. Jacob was a man that was causing problems even before he was born. I tell you, you have to work to be in that situation. But while he was yet in his mother's womb, he was causing confusion. You'll remember the story back in Genesis chapter number 25, Isaac entreats for his wife because she's barren. And Rebekah conceives, and the Bible said that the twins were struggling together in her. She goes and prays and basically asks the Lord, why in the world is this going on? And the Lord tells her that there's two nations that are struggling inside of her. And two manner of peoples would be separated from her. And we read on down in Genesis 25 that as the children were born, the first one came out and he was red and hairy all over. They called his name Esau, because Esau means red. And after that, his brother came out. And his brother, again, you'll remember the account, had reached up and grabbed Esau's heel. And because of that, they called him Jacob. Jacob means thief or a supplanter. It's as if, I don't know if y'all ever did this when you were kids, but you see somebody walking or maybe running down the field and you just kind of try to trip them up a little bit. That's what has in mind. Somebody lying in wait and here comes a person walking back and you reach out and grab them by the heel and try to make them stumble. That's what Jacob's name meant, and he really lived up to it. He was a rascal. He spent his whole life relying on trickery and his wit, lying and deception to get whatever it was that he wanted. But praise the Lord, there'd come a time in his life when he would meet the Lord, and the Lord would master him, and the Lord would mark him. You can go back and read about it in Genesis 32. Again, we're just kind of passing over some of his history, but you'll remember there was a time when he was left alone and he wrestled all night with an angel. And as they're wrestling, the angel just simply reaches out and touches the strongest part of a human's body, his thigh, and his thigh was just a whole lot of joint. And Jacob never walked the same after that. Matter of fact, the last time you read about Jacob in the Bible is in Hebrews 25, and he's pictured there as worshiping God, leaning upon his staff. God changed the way he's walked. God even changed his name. And again, go back there to Genesis 32, and the angel asked Jacob what his name was. And Jacob says, well, my name's Jacob. Now understand, the Lord knew what Jacob's name was. He wasn't trying to get information to make sure he had a hold of the right fellow. He was wanting a confession. For when Jacob says, my name is Jacob, he's like saying, I'm a thief, I'm a scoundrel, I'm a crook. The angel says, you're not going to be called Jacob anymore. But you're going to be called Israel. Because as a prince with God, thou hast power and prevail. So his name has changed to Israel. But I find something interesting. In Genesis 32, his name is changed. But if you'll start from Genesis 33 on through the rest of the book of Genesis, every time he is spoken of as an individual, he is referred to as Israel 39 times, but he's referred to as Jacob 60 times. So even after God changed his name from Jacob to Israel, he's still called Jacob more than he's called Israel. I think that's a way of letting us know, even though God did a work in his life, there was an old nature that he wrestled with every day. And he still had a tendency to fall back and do things his own way. And it was a continual work that God was doing in the life of Jacob, just like it's a continual work that God does in our lives from day to day. And we see God continuing that work here in Genesis chapter 35. The Lord speaks to him in verse number 1, and he says, Jacob, I want you to arise, get up from where you are, and I want you to go back to Bethel. Now, what was Bethel to Jacob? Go back and read about it in Genesis 28, and we'll look at some of it here in just a little bit. But Bethel to Jacob was the very first place he met God. And basically what God is saying to Jacob here, I want you to go back to the beginning of your walk with me. I want you to go back to that first fresh encounter that you and I had, and I want us to start all over from there. I want us, if you'll allow me to use the phrase, to begin again. I always think about this passage of Scripture I said during this time of year because I think here in what, just some 30 hours or so, we'll have a brand new year set before us. A brand new year full of potential, full of possibilities. A new year that's going to be full of problems and heartache and grief, but at the same time, there'll be joy and there'll be blessings. But as we close out this year, and as we spend some time looking back, and as we draw near to this upcoming year and spend some time looking forward, I wonder, would not the Lord say the same thing to you and to me? That it would be good for us to go back to those first encounters that we had with Him. To go back when our relationship with Him was fresh and new. Before we got so wound up in all that we're wound up in. Before we got too smart by half. Before we thought we had everything all figured out. To go back when there was still some excitement and some mystery and some joy in our lives. I find repeatedly where the Lord calls His people to return. Isaiah chapter 42, verse number 22. The Lord just simply says, return unto me, for I have redeemed thee. Malachi 3:7, the Lord says, return unto me, and I will return unto you. James says, draw nigh to the Lord and He will draw nigh unto you. Now notice who has the responsibility to make the first action there. I recognize God is the one that has initiated salvation in our life. And God is the one that sent His Son. And God is the one that sent His Spirit to convict us. And it's God's mercy that saves us. But it's you and I that's wandered off. And that's why James calls us to draw nigh to God first, and then He'll draw nigh to you. And why God says through the prophet Malachi, return unto me, and I will return unto you. That great address that Jesus gave to the church there at Ephesus in Revelation chapter 2. When He talked about all the wonderful things that church had been done, and He bragged on them on their stand they had taken doctrinally and the faithfulness that they had shown toward His Word. He said, I've got somewhat against you. He said, you've left your first love. Beloved, I want you to know you can be as straight as a gun barrel theologically, but as hollow as a gun barrel in your experience too. And I'm so fearful that's where we are. I'm so fearful we spend our time bragging about how straight we are in what we believe that we've become bankrupt in our experience and our love and our joy and our fellowship. And that's why the Lord says, remember from whence thou hast fallen and repent and repeat. Go do the first works again. So that's what I want us to think about as we work our way through these few verses tonight in Genesis 35. And let's see if the Lord might not stir our hearts to take us back to a deeper time in our walk with Him. First off, I want us to consider here the reasons why the Lord is calling Jacob back. The reasons for beginning again. I don't know about you, but I'm thankful God is not content just letting me go through this life and do what I want to do. He'll intervene, He'll correct, He'll chasten. He'll put traps and problems in my life to help me be aware of my need to walk closer to Him. And I'm so thankful God didn't say, all right, you saved, figure it out the best you can. No, the Lord is interested in my life, and the Lord desires to me to walk with Him. And there are times He'll say, fella, you need to straighten up. And you need to go back. Well, what was it here in Jacob's life that the Lord would have called him to come back? Well, back up to Genesis chapter 28. Let me just share you a few simple things with you here. Hang on to chapter 35. We'll be right back here in just a moment. But Genesis 28 gives for us the account that Genesis 35 is talking about. And Jacob needed to go back to Bethel, first off, because his vision was faded. Verse number 1, Jacob is basically having to run from Esau now, and he's being sent to get a wife. Verse number 10, he's traveling, and he went out from Beersheba. He's headed toward Haran. Verse 11, the Bible says, and he lighted upon a certain place and tarried there all night because the sun was set. And he took of the stones of that place and put them for his pillows and lay down in that place to sleep. For just a moment, put yourself here. Here's Jacob. He's left home. You remember, Jacob was kind of a mama's boy. So he'd probably never done this before. Jacob's left home and he's out in the wilderness, alone at night. They didn't have the conveniences of lights and hotels and everything to sleep at, and all Jacob's got to do is scratch around and try to find a comfortable rock to lay his head on. I don't know about you, but that don't seem real appealing to me. And here's Jacob. He's left home. His heart's probably filled with all kind of anxiety. What in the world is he going to find when he gets down to Haran? How in the world did he allow his life to get in this shape? Verse number 12, the Bible said, and he dreamed, and behold, a ladder was set upon the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven. And behold, the angels of God ascending and descending on it. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord God of Abraham, thy father, and the God of Isaac, and the land wherein thou liest, to thee will I give it, and to thy seed. And thy seed shall be as the dust of the earth, and thou shalt spread abroad to the west, and to the east, and to the north, and to the south. And in thee and in thy seed shall all the families of the earth be blessed. And behold, I am with thee, and will keep thee in the way whither thou goest, and will bring thee again into the land, for I will not leave thee until I have done that which I have spoken to thee of. And we'll get to it in just a minute, but verse number 16, Jacob wakes up and he basically says, wow! God was in this place, and I knew it not. And that's how the name How the place gets its name. Bethel literally means the house of God. Before, it was called Luz, which means emptiness and barrenness. So God manifests himself here, and for the first time, Jacob encounters God, and suddenly his life kind of makes some sense. He knows that God is directing him, and God is guiding him, and God is going to use him, and the vision that he has just seen is real and fresh, and it gives him meaning and purpose in life. By the time you get to Genesis 35, that vision has done faded. Jacob's no longer thinking about the Lord and the Lord's plan and purpose for his life. He had his eye over on his brother-in-law's riches. He wanted to get Laban's wealth. And then he got worried about Esau and what Esau was going to do to him when he came back home. And then he got all upset about his kids and the way they were acting and the confusion they were causing. His vision became cloudy, was faded because he was not focusing on the Lord as he should. And I dare say tonight that we oftentimes find ourselves in the same predicament. When was the last time we sat down and contemplated on who the Lord was and what all he would have us to do? When our heart and our attention was drawn solely to him. Now we're pulled 100 different ways and we're not giving anybody our full attention because we don't know what to pay attention to. We come to church and we hadn't prayed as we should. We hadn't studied as we should because we're worried about what's going to happen here and what's going to happen over there. And we're not doing those things that would be pleasing in God's sight because we've lost sight of who God is and who we are in him. He needed to go back to Bethel because his vision had faded. No longer was the Lord and his beauty the primary focus of Jacob's life. He had allowed the world to sidetrack. His visions had faded. Secondly, you'll notice with me as we go on down through Genesis 28, his vows had been forgotten. Verse 16, Jacob wakened out of his sleep and said, "Surely the Lord was in this place, and I knew it not." And he was afraid and said, "How dreadful is this place! This is none other than the house of God. This is the gate of heaven." And Jacob arose up early in the morning and took the stone that he had put for his pillows and set them up for a pillar and poured oil upon the top of it. And he called the name of the place Bethel, but the name of that city was called Luz at first. And Jacob vowed a vow, notice verse 20, saying, "If God will be with me and will keep me in the way that I go, and will give me bread to eat and raiment to put on, so that I come again to my father's house in peace, then shall the Lord be my God, and this stone which I have set up for a pillar shall be God's house, and all that thou shalt give me, I will surely give the tenth unto thee." Jacob started making God some promises here. "Lord, if you'll do this, if you'll bless me, if you'll keep me safe, if you'll bring me back home, then I'll do this, 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 and that." You know what? God did everything Jacob asked. But not one time do you see Jacob fulfilling the vow that he made to the Lord. At least not up through chapter number 35. His vows had been forgotten. How quick are we in a moment of joy, or maybe in a moment of pain, to start making promises to God? "Lord, if you'll solve this problem, I'll do this." Or, "God, you've blessed me so much, I'm going to do this." And we're quick to make those vows. It seems like we're even quicker to forget them. Just as soon as the moment passes, just as
soon as the Lord works problems out, or just as soon as things turn a little down, we're quick to neglect to fulfill our vows that we've made. I'm sure you're familiar with that passage in Ecclesiastes chapter 5 where Solomon tells us that if we make a vow, defer not to pay that vow, for God hath no pleasure in fools. He said it's better not to make a vow than to make a vow than not keep the vow. That's why I'm not real big on these New Year's resolutions and all these plans and things that people make, because the vast majority of them don't go anywhere. But I want to encourage you tonight. I want to encourage you to look ahead and make some vows and strive by the grace of God to keep them. And how many times at the beginning of the year have you said, I'm going to read my Bible through this year? And you made it through maybe March, and that's as far as it went. Or how many times have you said, I want to witness to this many people, or I want to give out this many tracts, or I want to go to this many Bible hands out, whatever the case might be. And you really mean good, but you kind of forget that as you begin to go through your life. We need to go back to that first encounter, back when those vows were fresh. So his visions had faded. His vows have been forgotten. But also, as we read through Jacob's life here, we see that his victories had been few. Oh, there were times that you see the Lord blessed him, sure. But as you read about him leaving Bethel here, he leaves with full confidence and great boldness in what the Lord's going to do. And it doesn't take him long to get down to Laban's house, and he's back playing his old games again. And if you're not familiar with some of the turmoil in his home life, it'd do you good to go back and read through it. I mean, he winds up getting married to four different women, and that just creates all kind of problems. His kids grow up, and they cause him all kind of problems, and it just seems like one headache after another. You want to know why a lot of it happened? A lot of it happened because Jacob was living outside the will of God and didn't go back where he was supposed to win, and didn't fulfill those vows that he was supposed to fulfill. See, at the time in Genesis chapter number 35, when God calls Jacob to go back to Bethel, he's living in Shechem. Shechem literally means a place of burdens. And instead of dwelling in the house of God, where he promised the Lord he would go back to, he said, this is going to be your house here. He's living in the land of burden, not finding any joy in his life. And the Lord says, Jacob, it's time to go back. Well, what hypocrisy there appears so oftentimes in our song services, even. We'll stand and we'll sing, I surrender all, and we haven't surrendered a thing. We'll stand and sing about victory in Jesus, and we're living in defeat. And we need, as Jacob needed, to go back and get right with God again. Now, let me just open parentheses and say this. You cannot go back to somewhere you've never been. You cannot rededicate something to the Lord that's never been dedicated in the first place. Jacob could go back to Bethel because Jacob had had an encounter with God. If you never had an encounter with God, you don't have anything to go back to. You need to recognize that and trust him initially. So the reasons for beginning again, his visions were faded, his vows were forgotten, and his victories were few. But notice with me Genesis 35 again as we look into verse number 2. There's some requirements that's given to us here. There are some things that Jacob and his household had to do before they went back. Notice three things given to us in our text here. And Jacob said unto his household and all that were with him, first off, put away the strange gods that are among you. See, they can't go back to Bethel and carry their little household gods with them. They can't go back and worship the God of Bethel, which is in verse number 7, El Bethel. That's what that means. It means the God of the house of God. They weren't just returning to a place, they were returning to a person. And Jacob said, if we're going back to the true and living God, we cannot bring these idols with us. So take them and get rid of them. There had to be a refocusing of their attention on the true Almighty God. Now, idolatry was introduced to Jacob's family very early on. Remember that his favorite wife, Rachel, stole her father's gods when they left. And that's one of the reasons Laban pursued after them. At that time, Jacob didn't realize what had taken place. He didn't realize that Rachel had stolen these things. But years have passed now, and Jacob knows there's idolatry going on in his family. And you know what? He seems to have let it go on. But now it's time to get right with God. Now it's time for these things to go. See, beloved, we can't go back to Bethel and carry our little gods along with us. We're going to have to get rid of them. We're going to have to get rid of those things that are so near and dear to our heart. Those things that have become the focus of our attention and that have become the desire of our hearts that are not helping us walk with the Lord, not helping us fellowship with Him. We're going to lay those things down. The author of Hebrews put it this way in Hebrews chapter 12. Wherefore, seeing we are compassed about with so great a cloud of witness, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us. I was thinking about those two things this afternoon. We recognize the sin and the need to get rid of that. But before that, he says, let us lay aside every weight. And I think he mentioned that first because it's that weight that oftentimes it leads us to that sin. Those things in our life that might not necessarily be evil and be wrong, but they are not helping us run the race that the Lord has called us to. They are a weight upon us. And God says, let's get rid of those things. Let's set those things aside. And the sin which does so easily beset us, and by the way, I don't know what your besetting sin is, and you don't know what mine is, but I'm persuaded, and the more I talk to people, the more I'm persuaded this. There are just certain areas in our life that we have problems with, and you probably know automatically off the top of your head what yours is. That the devil keeps using to trip you up time and time again. That's that sin that does so easily beset us, but it's brought about by that weight that we're trying to pull around. And the Lord says, lay them aside. It's like Jacob tells his family here, we've got all these gods here, these strange gods that you're worshiping. It's time to put them away. It's time to remove them. William Cowper would write in his great hymn, the dearest idol I have known, whate'er that idol may be, help me tear it from thy throne and worship only thee. He says, put away the strange gods. But notice, he goes on in verse number 2 and he says, and be clean. Repent. Turn from those things that are so offensive. Be clean. I get into hearing people talking all the time about repentance and what repentance is. Is repentance a change of mind? Is it a change of heart? Is it a change of action? And the answer is yes. It's a change of heart that leads to a change of mind, that leads to a change of action. And if all those things don't happen, then what you've experienced is not genuine repentance. It's just remorse because you're sorry you got caught in what you're doing. And there's a big difference here. Jacob is saying, look, we're going to get these things. And you go on down and you see that Jacob hid those things from them, those idols and everything there in verse number 4. Jacob got their strange gods and their earrings and all those things, and he hit them where they couldn't get back to them again. They were never going to come back. And that's involved in this idea of being clean, repenting, straightening up, and being what the Lord would have us to be. And again, thank God he's made provision for us to do that. For if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and to cleanse us, the scripture says, from all unrighteousness. Put away, be clean, he says in verse number 2. And change your garments. What good would it do you to take a bath and then put your dirty clothes back on? He says, look, where we're going, we want everything to be fresh. We want everything to be new. We don't want the stain of anything that we've been involved with coming along with us. Get good and clean. I think about this idea of putting away. Isaiah 1:16, the prophet said, wash you, make you clean, put away the evil of your doings from before mine eyes. Cease to do evil. I think about that putting away. You ever watch a kid, and I guess today it really don't have to be a kid, it can be just about anybody, that gets a hold of those little video games. I don't play them simply for this reason. I don't play them because I'd get addicted to them in a heartbeat. I know that, so I don't even bother playing with them. But my kids love to play them. And they'll sit there and they'll play them for a little while, and I'll say, all right, it's time to shut off. Let's go to dinner. And we'll sit there around the table, and you know what they're talking about? That blooming video game. How to beat this boss, or how to get over past this level, and how you do that. See, they stopped playing, but they hadn't put it away. They hadn't changed things. They hadn't got things right yet. And Jacob is saying, look, we want to go back. We want to go back right. Change your garments. The prophet spoke about how the Lord could give us garments of praise for the spirit of heaviness and all that we might be able to experience that. But I give you one last thought and we'll be done this evening as we look on down through chapter 35. The reasons for going back and the requirements. Notice, if you could, the rewards that come. Notice what they found. They found peace. Verse number 5. The Bible says, and they journeyed, and the terror of God was upon the cities that were round about them, and they did not pursue after the sons of Jacob. Now, to understand that a little bit, you need to go back to chapter number 34. Jacob had a daughter by the name of Dinah, and she's defiled in the previous chapter, and her brothers take it upon themselves to basically destroy everybody that was in that city. And the end of chapter 34, Jacob is thinking, oh my goodness, they're going to come on us and they're going to wipe every one of us off. Or wipe every one of us out, rather. And God so worked here that God gave them safe passage, and God gave them liberty, and God gave them peace to get out of that land. And he's able in verse number 6 to go back to Bethel, to the place where God had met with him. Now the scripture says when a man's ways please the Lord, he even makes his enemies to be at peace with him. And isn't it a wonderful thing to be at peace? It's amazing how often you hear people talking about peace today. You'll hear them talking about peace conferences and peace in the Middle East and peace among races and peace among this and peace among that. And most of them don't even have peace in their own heart, let alone having peace anywhere else. But what a wonderful thing to be at peace with God. And by faith we can be at peace with God. But not only be at peace with God, to have the peace of God. You want something to think on. Go home and think on that phrase, the peace of God, which Paul said that would passes all understanding. When we're anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication and thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. I can not only be at peace with God, I can have the peace of God. I want you to know tonight, friend, there's no panic in heaven. God's not wringing his hands thinking, oh no, what am I going to do next? He's at peace. And I can have that peace in my life when I get back to that place God would have me to be. He found peace. He found purpose. Back down in verse number 9, the Lord meets with Jacob again, and Jacob is reminded once again of God's plan and God's purpose for him. And wouldn't it be a wonderful thing to go back again to that time in our life when God's plan and God's purpose for us was clear? We had a young man surrender to preach in our church just a, I don't know, time gets away from me, 4, 5, 6 weeks ago now, I don't remember when it was. And I was telling my pastor, I said, on a big way, I'm jealous of him. He said, what do you mean? I said, well, he's still young. He's still excited. He still thinks he's going to make a difference somewhere. He hadn't been cussed out yet. He hadn't went and preached his first Sunday night message when half the congregation won't show back up. He's still fresh. He's still got this vision. I said, let's face it, brother. I said, you and I just kind of lost our fire in a lot of areas. He said, yeah, I guess you're right. And all to go back to that time when you was just excited to see what the Lord was going to do, to have a purpose, to have something you are working toward. I promise you, whatever job you're involved in, you don't just show up and expect things to happen. You work at Lazy Boy, you've got a production schedule that they've got, some things they anticipate. You teach school, you've got lesson plans that you work up and you plan to go on. Now, I recognize our little world can get upset in a hurry and things can come in we didn't anticipate. That's no reason for not anticipating. Listen, you're not going to serve the Lord faithfully by just waking up in the morning and seeing what the day holds. You're going to have some plans and some purpose about you. And that's what Jacob found when he got back to Bethel. But finally, let me say, Jacob got rekindled and he got the power to carry out the life the Lord would have him to live. Now, I'm not telling you, you get back to Bethel, everything's going to be fine and dandy. Verse number 8 of our text, Deborah, one of Jacob's wife, dies. Verse number 16 of our text, Jacob's favorite wife, Rachel, dies. And that happens while they're at Bethel. So I'm not telling you tonight that there is a life that is awaiting you that's free of problem and hardship. I'm not telling you that there is a life that is awaiting you that's always sunshine and roses. No. I'm telling you, there's a life out there that's full of purpose and power, and God can grant grace sufficient to do those things that He would have us do. Hosea 10:12, sow to yourselves in righteousness and reap in mercy. Break up your fallow ground, for it is time to seek the Lord till He come and rain righteousness upon you. I was thinking about that phrase, fallow ground. I didn't really know what it was, so I went and looked it up. God said, break up your fallow ground. Fallow ground is ground that at one time was plowed and ready to receive seed, but it never was sown. You know what's going to happen to the ground if it don't sow seed in it? It's just going to go right back to being unproductive. It's going to produce thorns and thistles and weeds. And God says you need to go back and break that up again and re-sow it and trust the Lord to send the rain so that the fruit can grow. I dare say over the past 12 months, or maybe I shouldn't say it for you, I know over the past 12 months I've let some ground go fallow in my life. I've got a lot of things that I get started on and I think, no, I have something else over here, and I get pulled off of that, there's something else over here, and go... And I look back and I've plowed a whole lot and put very few seed in the ground. And I pray the Lord might give us grace to break up that ground and allow Him to put His word, and send the rain, and allow it to truly be productive, to draw nigh unto Him, so that He might draw nigh unto us. The Lord said unto Jacob, Jacob, you're not accomplishing anything here. It's time for you to rise and to go back to Bethel. And if that's what you stand in need of tonight, I pray the Lord might bless His word to your heart so that you might yield yourself in fresh obedience to Him. Let's pray together. Father, we thank You for these few moments that You've blessed us with. And Lord, as we come to the close of this current year, Lord, I can look back and I can see so many times that You've blessed and You've helped. So many times when You've directly intervened in situations that we've prayed about. But Lord, for every one of those that I can see, there are multitudes that You've worked in, and I hadn't seen You work, but You've worked nonetheless. And Lord, as we look forward, we look forward with confidence that You'll be able to continue to work and help us. And I pray You might help us to have a fresh vision in our heart and our life. Pray You'd help us to walk in that victory that we sing about. Again, we lift up those families to You that were mentioned earlier, those that are in need of a touch physically, those that are hurting. Especially the Robinson family and the loss of their loved one. God, You might bless and comfort there. Lord, I pray that You would be with this church, that You would send to them the pastor that they need. I pray You might help them to have wisdom as they seek and search Him out. Grant them, Lord, of Your patience and Your direction. We pray for those that hold leadership positions, that, Lord, they might strive through that faithfully. And they might serve to be a blessing and help here. We pray for the upcoming Lord's Day Sunday, Lord, that You might just bless and direct. May those that stand in the pulpits, Lord, send forth Your word to Your people. May the saved, Lord, be strengthened and encouraged. May the lost recognize their need and come and trust Jesus. And in all things, may You be honored and may You be glorified. Be with us as we depart this place tonight. Watch over us to our respective homes. And help us start through the rest of this week and help us to prepare our hearts for Sunday. All these things we do ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Brother Douglas, Brother Brent, whoever wants to. I know y'all are waiting on the other group out of the